All right, good morning everyone. Just wanted to share a quick primer on the problem that I think we all should understand before we can talk about the solution, which, spoiler, I think is Bitcoin. But before we can talk about a solution, we need to understand the problem, and not that many people understand the problem that they have. I didn't understand the problem that I have until I was 30 and I already had a mortgage. I was working at a bank until a colleague told me, "Did you know that the money in the bank is actually not yours?" And I said, "Excuse me, like, what do you mean?" And mind you, I was already into Bitcoin. But I wasn't here yet. I didn't understand this. So we took some time and he explained to me fractional reserve banking, how banks, when you deposit money in a bank as an individual, the bank uses that money to loan that out to other people and make money of it. And when that goes well, the bank gets all the profits. And when that goes bad, you get also the bad results. You either don't get your money back, or maybe there is some state insurance, right? But where does the state get their money? Also from you. So, you know, they taught me about this system. But that is problematic in one sense, but that is not the problem I want to talk about. The problem I want to talk about is, you know, the question that is something question that we have not answered, especially not in our education, is what is money? And for me, simply, what is money is, I see money as a communications technology, basically. If I do something for you, I build a shed in your backyard, then we agree what the value of that is. That what I do or create for you, right? So every time there is a transaction between two people, a want surfaced by an offer or supply of something. At the moment of the exchange, there's an agreement between the two parties of that exchange. And so we communicate value with each other, either on paper or through our voice, right? We do a handshake and then we exchange value. But what is the value that is exchanged? To the core, I see that as energy. If I build that shed in your backyard, I expend physical energy, I expend energy from my mind. I have to build a plan for building the shed. I have to buy wood, which is also created by energy, the energy of the sun, the energy of the earth. There's energy that went into creating the beams, for example. So when you look around, everything you see is created or maintained by energy. Energy usage is good. Projected energy usage is really good. That's how we build amazing things. So what we exchange with each other is energy. If I create that, build that shed for you. But what do you give me in return? In return, you give me what we call money. So you give me coins and bills, or you send me some numbers on the banking app. And those numbers, that amount of units of the currency that you use, so euro or dollars or whatever, that is what represents the energy that I expend to create the shed in the backyard for you. So let's say that is 1,000 units of the currency that your country lets you use, right? Let's go with 1,000 euros. Or dollars is a better example. Let's go for $1,000. At that moment in time, when we exchange this energy, right, my physical energy, again, and the energy that's represented by the units of the currency that you give me, at that moment it's equal. But once I expended this energy, my finite energy, by the way, my finite directional energy in an amount of time, in the time that I built the shed for you, and time is my most finite resource, it's the most finite resource of everyone in the world, right? Nobody knows how much time they have, so it's very important that you spend the right time on the right thing. But if I spend that time, then it's gone, and I get captured energy in the form of money in return from you. But what if I am saving up to start a company? I want to save money. I want to save $100,000. Not a thousand. I want to save $100,000. So I can start another company, or I can grow my company, right? I can save that money, those amounts of units, into the future to, again, use that to buy other people's energy. People that do things for me, or materials I need to buy. Again, everything costs energy to create or maintain. So if I don't want to spend the units when I receive them from you after I build your shed, I want to save them towards the future, right? But here is the problem. The problem is that the money that we are forced to use by your government is not open, it's not equal for us. It's not a fair money. There are people that we cannot identify, that we did not choose, and they determine what the value of the money is that we use to exchange value with each other. And they choose what the value is based not on open dialogue or scientific research or big consensus. It's a small group of people that decides what that money is worth. And usually that is measured by inflation. And their goal is 2% inflation. So every year, the units that you have to pay, the units of money you have to pay for goods and services, goes up by 2%, which means the value of each unit goes down by 2% each year. And that's how they want to incentivize spending from people, because their philosophy is that is the only way white people would spend the money that is used in the economy. I would argue that there's always certain human needs like food and shelter and transport and, you know, whatever people want. We are all perhaps inherently lazy, but we all want to contribute. So there's always something to spend money on. We should not be incentivized by a third party to tell us what to do. But again, the problem is that there is a small group of people that decide what the value of the money is that the majority of the people, the 99.99% of people, actually use to exchange value with each other. And why is that problematic? It's problematic because if I want to save that $100,000 towards the future, and I need 2 years to do it, then and I have 100,000 units at the end of those 2 years, the value, what I can actually buy with it, has gone down. Now that's weird. I expended my finite energy and time, and I got something that does not represent that anymore. And how is this inflation created? Then we come back to also the fractional reserve banking. So it's not only created by printing of money by governments, it's even more created by the creation of money by banks. Because when you deposit $1,000 in the bank can lend that out 10 times over. So they create $9,000. They can loan out your initial $1,000, but they also create $9,000 on paper, but they are not actually there. So they create more units of the currency that you're forced to use to serve their own business interests. That is the problem. The problem is more units of the currency are created every day when we all participate in this system, either getting a mortgage or credit or whatever. We participate in the system and therefore are also diluting the value of the units of the currency that we already have. So, if we stop taking the example of the shed and we take an example of an apple, what is the energy you need to grow an apple? Do you think that has changed in the past million years, or how old apples are? Take a million years. The amount of sunlight, the amount of rain, the amount of food for the apple tree. Do you think that's changed to grow one apple? The amount of energy that went into one apple? I can rationally say it's not. It didn't change. Do you think an apple costs more units of the currency you're forced to use than 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago? Hell yeah. So that's interesting, right? The amount of energy captured in an apple is the same, but the amount of units that represent energy, as we talked about before, that does change. You need more units of that currency. Does that mean the apple has become more valuable in terms of energy? No. It means that the units that you use to pay for the apple, to do the value exchange, became worth less. They are now worth less. And that is a perpetual, that is in a perpetual motion. Every unit of the currency that you hold is eroding in value every day. That is the problem that we have. And again, look around. Everything you see costs energy to create or maintain. Anything. Why is a bread $5 or 5 euros? Why is it a joke that 40 years ago it was 25 cents? It's like we are going back in time, right? Everything that is new is always expensive because it's new and people invested in creating this new thing. But over time, the technology gets democratized and everything becomes cheaper. It deflates. You need less units of a currency to pay for the same thing, for it to eventually become free. Look at your phone. Your iPhone is a crazy supercomputer. Much better of a computer that sent a rocket to space with people in it. Wild. When I was in high school, I bought a scientific calculator, like a Texas Instruments calculator. It was 200 euros. Now I can do that on my phone for free. And that's the entire point of our progression as humans, our innate need and want to improve ourselves, to become more productive, because we are lazy. We want to be more productive. We want to be more effective. We want to invent things that make our life easier. So why is bread not free? Why don't I have like a little pill that I put in water and a bread pops out? You know, that's the whole joke, the same joke as with why we wanted flying cars. Yeah, of course, that's the entire idea. But why don't we have flying cars? Well, the deflationary force of technology, right? The prices, the units, the amount of units that you need going down is fighting against the amount of units that's going up, that's been created, the inflationary forces. And that is the problem that we have. That is why a bread is $5, right? We've gone back in time 100 years or back to the invention of bread.
So crazy. So crazy.
I hope I made it a bit clear with this rant. The entire point is that our progression as people is a deflationary force. Everything should become cheaper, everything should become democratized, everything should become more accessible to people. And we should have free bread. There should be no hunger in the world. We should be there already. But a bread is $5. Because we are fighting the inflationary forces of a broken money. The money is not open, it's not transparent, it's not decentralized. It's ruled by rulers. There are people that decide for us what our money is worth. They influence our daily life. They influence our value transactions. We should have a decentralized money that's hard to make, because that will hold its value. We should have a deflationary money. We should have a money that everyone can verify, of which everyone can verify the rules. And that is eventually what hopefully will lead more people to Bitcoin. But we can only talk about the solution if we understand the problem. Let me know what you think. If I missed some things, just jamming in the morning. And I wish you all an amazing day. Peace.